acquired them. And I couldn't help but study their context. If you know German hymnals, say, from the 18th or even 19th century, you know that oftentimes not a lot of information is given about the hymn. Oftentimes the authors are not, we certainly don't have the music. So this study originated as I found a couple of hymnals that were rather rare, and I tried to identify authors in order to ascertain a theological background for the publication of these hymnals. So I have called this Translation and Transformation, Rationalism and Hymnody in 19th Century American Lutheranism. Now, the 18th century produced numerous developments in the sphere of theology, philosophy, and social structures, witnessing the success of the French and American revolutions, during which the maxim of life, liberty, and property became embedded within the minds of social classes that previously had been limited in their attainments. Intellectual and humanistic pursuits cultivated by the Renaissance came to fruition during this age of reason. The rationalist fervor of the age, while beneficial for scientific progress, posed a challenge for the church in the criticism of its theology and its practices. So the content of 19th century American Lutheran hymnals and church books, therefore, somewhat reflects the struggle between Lutheran orthodoxy and this newfound faith in reason. Now first, we must acknowledge the role that human thinking played in the development of Reformation ideals. Martin Luther's quotations on reason have been notoriously taken out of context in later centuries, but it is true that he looked askance on reason as an epistemological tool, at least for faith is concerned. He famously stated in a sermon of 1537 that, quote, "He who does not kill and bury his reason and become as a little child does not enter into the kingdom of heaven. If men bury reason, let its eyes be put out, and let themselves be carried and led to Christ, then the kingdom of heaven is theirs," unquote. Yet, Luther was certainly a Renaissance humanist in many ways, valuing human intellect and personal autonomy. He stated that one, quote, "must differentiate between God and men, or between the eternal and the temporal. In temporal things and human relations, man is rational enough. There he needs no other light than reason. So God does not teach us in scripture how to build houses, make clothing, marry, wage wars, sail on the seas, and the like, for there our natural light is sufficient. But in divine things, that is, in those which pertain to God, and which must be so performed as to be acceptable to him and obtain salvation for us, our nature is so stark and stone-blown as to be unable to recognize them at all," unquote. Luther's hymnody, therefore, reflects this Christocentricity, centered as it was on Christ's life and hence the liturgical year, the sacraments, and just generally teaching the fundamentals of Christianity. In response to the so-called wars of religion, particularly the Thirty Years' War, 1618-1648, there developed a softening of theological polemic, which tended to pit creedal institutional Christianity against the warmer personal faith, perhaps famously championed by Lutheran theologians such as Johann Arndt and Philip Spener. Now, Philip Spener's seminal 1675 work, Pia Desiderium, or Heartfelt Desire for God-Pleasing Reform, would become a handbook for what became known as Pietism, a movement that emphasized personal faith and righteous behavior, sometimes against mere doctrinal concerns. Now, the great hymn writer Paul Gerhardt represented a very early type of Pietism. Indeed, he died only a year after Spener's book was written, placing hymns in the first person for the first time in German hymnody, in spite or because of his experiences of crippling hardship during the Thirty Years' War. Gerhardt managed to fashion hymns of unique beauty and Christocentricity, all while offering words that the Christian can sing to God, as with this hymn, "Ich singe dir mit ganzem Mund." O joy, O Lord, I sing with mouth and heart, joy of my soul to thee. To earth thy knowledge I impart, as it is known to me. Pietism would develop into different strands as the centuries progressed, until such point at which the hymnody was largely anthropocentric, perhaps more akin to romantic poetry of the time than to a hymn inspired by scripture, certainly different from Luther's. Consider a stanza from this hymn for the first Lutheran hymnal published in America. We'll talk about it in a second. Entitled Küsse mich, the translation is, "Kiss me, O chosen one, for you are the most lovely. Come, my brother firstborn, for I feel a longing pain. Behold, I am sick with love. Your salve strengthens me, flowing from your tender heart, O bridegroom. I am sick with love, this I know." Pietism, in shifting its emphasis to personal feelings and experiences, would serve as a handmaiden to nascent rationalism, which sought to improve the world not only through technology and science, but also through the improvement of morals. Let's then turn to the United States and the Lutheran theological developments there. Pennsylvania soon became a center for German colonization, both for Lutheran and Reformed settlers. Heinrich Muhlenberg, the highly trained so-called father of American Lutheranism, is credited with compiling the first Lutheran hymnal published in the United States, the Urbella Gebetosam. This is not 1786, this is 1795, I'm sorry to say. The Lutheran ministerial delegates who enjoined Muhlenberg with the task of producing a hymnal for the new American nation in 1782 felt comfortable enough that Muhlenberg's theology was sufficiently representative of American Lutheranism that such an endeavor would result in a useful and popular hymnal congruent with a theological zeitgeist. Now, the Urbella Gebetosam, it's arranged topically with a liturgical year placed at the beginning of the volume, consistent with other contemporary gesangbücher. Of the 688 total hymns, 183 are devoted to the liturgical year. Not surprisingly, for those who know and study Pietist hymnals, the largest category of liturgical hymns is the Lenten section, here called On the Sorrows and Death of Jesus Christ, which when you add to the following section, presumably devoted to Good Friday, On the Death of Jesus Christ, comprises 38 hymns. In comparison, there are 17 hymns devoted to Advent and Christmas together, while only 12 to Easter. Now, for a lack of more objective means to categorize theological approach, the hymn writers represented in this hymnal fall under these chronological categories, which admittedly are somewhat arbitrary and, of course, are not necessarily theological, but they are telling. I identified the authors of 525 of the 688 hymns, so Orthodox, so roughly from the 16th century up to about the 30 Years' War, 93. Early Pietist, here about Gerhard's time, 127. Post-Gerhard, 207. Rationalist, so contemporary, late 19th century, 38, and non-Lutheran, 37. Now, Muhlenberg was helped by the fact that he needn't have worried about English translations. He had access to the contemporary German Gesangbücher, which the colonists had brought over. He had a wealth of German language hymnody at his disposals, and he was unhindered by copyright concerns. Of the 525 hymns for which I have been able to identify authors, Christian Fürchtegott Gellert is most represented, with 22 hymns throughout the book. Luther is represented by 20. Johann Rist is likewise represented by 22, and most of the other authors claim no more than 3 or 4 hymns each. Now, Gellert's important. He was a professor of theology in Leipzig who published these hymns and volumes of stories and fables. Very popular with the rationalist writers. Even given that I could only find and identify the authors of 72% of the hymnal, we see that Muhlenberg still looks to the early Lutheran hymnists to provide a goodly number of hymns, but that the greatest number of these hymns comes, not surprisingly, from the Pietist era, here defined rather loosely as the mid to late 17th century. 183 hymns, or 25%, are dedicated to Christ's life, as centered around the liturgical year. And this ratio is consistent with contemporary German hymnals, which no doubt provided the main source for Muhlenberg. This is Marburg Gesangbuch of 1792, which has 21% of its hymns devoted to the liturgical year. Now, for some reason, Pietists favored Lent over Easter, and this is evident in that there are 34 hymns devoted to Lent and 12 dedicated to Easter in Marburg. And strangely enough, Ascension gets 7. Yet, Muhlenberg devotes 6 hymns to baptism and 16 to the Lord's Supper, categories which traditionally have been favored in Lutheran hymns. Lutherans are sacramental, after all. Interestingly, back to Muhlenberg, he places 27 hymns in the category of true repentance and conversion. and 25 hymns to the Christian love. He invents a unique category of hymn called On True and False Christianity, in which he places 9 hymns. Again, speaking to his pietist background, the category On the Cross and Pain, which is arguably an extension of the Lenten section, receives 36 hymns, and that popular category of On the Judgment receives 56 hymns. Death and Resurrection receives 68, the largest single category in the book. Perhaps he had his Baptist friends in mind when he included that uniquely un-Lutheran category of unsurrendering of a heart to God. Now, Frederick Fickmont, 1760-1832, was one of the most important 19th century American Lutheran theologians, largely to be overlooked in the 20th century. But he represented Lutheran rationalism to its fullest. He denied or was stubbornly silent regarding the doctrines of sin, the Holy Trinity, and Christ's full divinity. And that is him this year. He writes in here, quote, "The sacred book, the Bible, is no encyclopedia or source from whence the knowledge of all the arts and sciences must be drawn. In dubious scriptural passages, we first must inquire what reason dictates and what daily experience teaches, and explain such passages accordingly. And since the art of magic or supernatural operations performed by the agency of spirits cannot be proved by reason or ascertained by experience, it follows that the scriptures cannot be looked to in this case." End quote. Elsewhere in this catechism, he writes, "Reason and revelation are the only sources from which religious knowledge is to be decided. Are not both reason and revelation descended from heaven, always in harmony and supporting each other?" Unquote. Now, this idea definitely contrasts with the historic Lutheran idea of faith superseding reason, of which Luther spoke, quote, "That which is to lead us to heaven must be something above our reason and wisdom." Fickmont's collection, A Collection of Hymns and a Liturgy for the Use of the Lutheran Churches, 1814, contains scarcely any material of Christian doctrinal conviction. In a hasty effort to collect English language hymnody, that was a challenge at the time, the book contained no translated Luther or Gerhardt, with contents coming from other denominations' book, or likely from Quitman's own pen. We just don't know. It's really hard to tell. In this volume, Quitman betrays his pietist training by including mostly hymns set in first person, while his rationalist background is apparent as he portrays God as a distant but benevolent being who is sought by humanity. Consider this third stanza from hymn 349. "Who with another's eyes can read or worship by another's creed? Trusting thy grace, we form our own and bow to thy commands alone." There seems to be a notion that personal, subjective faith cannot be reconciled with formal orthodoxy, as manifest through the traditional creeds. Quitman's rationalism also looks upon the establishment with great wariness. In one of his sermons preached in 1817, Fickmont expresses his distrust of authority, as he argues that, quote, "No man or combination of men has a right to rule over the consciousness of others, or to erect a general standard of religious faith and practice." Hymn 351 expounds upon this unionistic spirit, which kind of necessarily results if creeds and confessions are therefore detrimental to Christianity. He says, "Let party names no more the Christian world overspread. Gentile and Jew, in bond and free, are one in Christ, their head." Now, this Renaissance theism, indistinguishable in pietist and rationalist alike, comes to fruition only in one's behavior, not in assenting to certain doctrines. Now, in one of the very next hymns, Quitman allays any concern for his patriotism, asserting that the U.S. government is an extension of natural law. He says, "But chief to my country's voice, may my best thoughts incline. 'Tis reason's law, 'tis virtue's choice, 'tis nature's call and thine." This confluence of faith and reason in the stanza perhaps recalls Thomas Aquinas and the medieval scholastics, and while it's perhaps a viable theology for some, it does contradict Lutheran ideas of sin and human depravity as having inherently tarnished reason's capabilities. In another hymn, found Enlightenment Humanism Only formed erect, while roots bow down to earth, but that my soul should learn to know and claim its noble birth. Supreme and universal light, fountain of reason, judge of right, without whose kind directing ray in everlasting night we stray. Assist us, Lord, to act to be what all thy sacred laws decree, worthy that intellectual flame which from thy breathing spirit came. Friedman's theology is apparent in the blood-soaked stanzas which he excised from Isaac Watts' Alas and Did My Savior Bleed, which clearly states the doctrine of the atonement, which you will not find here. He omits, was it for crimes that I had done, he groaned upon the tree, amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. My body slain, sweet Jesus, thine and bathed in its own blood, while all exposed to wrath, divine the glorious sufferer stood. Further, Friedman alters Watts' stanza, when God the mighty maker died, to when Christ the mighty savior died. Perhaps he wished to disassociate as much as possible Christ's humanity from God's divinity. In the section entitled Repentance and Conversion is found a hymn which illustrates the intellectual nature of rationalist faith, very bottom. Blessed instructor, from thy ways, who can tell how oft he strays? Save from error's growth my mind, leave not, Lord, one root behind. This is probably hymnology's sole instance of addressing God as instructor. Quitman moves the worshiper from any sort of doctrinal orthocardia, as might be found in the German Pietist or even the English evangelicals, to a type of dry accession, intellectual accession to some ambiguous moralism. In 1817, on the commemoration of the 300th anniversary of the Reformation, the Pennsylvania Ministerium published the Gemeinschaftsgesang, the Union Hymnal. This is the first edition, but the title page is kind of ripped, so that's why you have that picture up there. It was designed to be used by German-speaking Lutheran and Reformed congregations who often shared the same church buildings in New England. Walt Quitman had eagerly embraced the English language in his 1814 catechism hymnal. This time, practicality seemed to mitigate, and this hymnal was produced in German. It contains 494 hymns. Four are baptism and 15 are communion hymns. Only 3.8% of the hymnal is devoted to sacramental hymns, while 19% is dedicated to special times and circumstances. You can see here the breakdown of interestingly, Ascension gets 10 hymns. Don't know what the appeal was about Ascension. Lutherans too often forget it these days. Again, 28 for Lent. Our percentage is there. So 19% is dedicated to special times and circumstances. Practical preaching was accompanied by practical singing. Some categories of hymns included are, I've translated these, knowledge of God through nature, not surprising. For the teacher, for and after the weather, in lean times, in times of war, songs of faith, songs for widows, waifs, orphans, and the poor, as well as the requisite categories dealing with the seasons and other concerns of an agrarian society. According to Quitman's preface, the hymnal is arranged according to the most practical means, i.e., the traditional liturgical arrangement of the hymnody has been abandoned in favor of a topical arrangement. 64 hymns, or 13% of the hymnal, is devoted to recounting Christ's life, with 28 hymns alone being dedicated to the season of Lent. Most of the Gesangbuch's hymn writers have been forgotten, as is typical of rationalist hymn writers. They include J.J. Eschenborg, D.S. Georgi, E. Küster, J.G. Mudva, a certain Woltersdorf, Peter Buss, Johann Schade, and Ehrenfried Liebig. The lack of Reformation canon leader, core hymnody from the 16th century, is decried by 20th century Lutheran theologian Luther Reed, who comments that, quote, the incapacity of the editors was revealed not only in the omission of the classic hymns of the church and the insertion of weak and frivolous hymns, but also in frequent errors in crediting authorship, unquote. Martin Luther, who is an author well represented in most German language Lutheran hymnals until this point, is represented by only one hymn, and it's Night of Mighty Fortress, it's Aus tiefer Not, Out of the Depth I Cry to Thee. is said in Psalm 130. Although Paul Gerhardt has 11 hymns. The staple writer of Rashbo's hymnody, the aforementioned Christian Fürstegott Gellert, has 40 hymns. So while it's hardly an exemplar of a confessional Lutheran hymnal, the book at least represents a slight retreat from Whitman's English language previous cult rationalism, perhaps mostly a practical function of having reverted back to the German language. So only in comparison to that hymnal liturgy of 1814 can this be seen to be an improvement. The rationalist approach to corporate worship in general didn't mean singing, especially the singing of the chorale, in favor of a practical, moralistic sermon or teaching. Likewise, extraneous liturgical elements which did not support the sermon directly were eagerly omitted. Samuel Schmucker, 1799 to 1873, an influential Lutheran theologian of the first half of the 19th century, summarizes well the pervading philosophy of music, worship, and liturgy. He writes, "The custom in our church in this country, as also in the Dutch Reformed Church, has been from time immemorial to use the liturgy only on synodical, sacramental, funeral, and wedding occasions, excepting in the cities and a few larger towns, where the populace appears to look with a more favorable eye upon forms and ceremonies," unquote. Schmucker's English language hymns, somewhere here, hymns selected and original, one of the longest published Lutheran hymnals in the United States, contains a total of 965 hymns, where he devotes 13% of its pages to the ambiguous category of Christian experience. The section on the kingdom and church of Christ might arguably also fall under a certain category of Christian experience, because the subcategories are very practically oriented. He has hymns devoted to having obtained a minister, sickness of a minister, the minister going on a journey, death of a minister. They must have had a problem with the minister. I don't know. Oh, in a state of revival. Very odd for Lutheran hymnal. For election of church officers, as well as general missionary hymns, to name only a few. In case this section fails to provide the necessary hymns for every conceivable occasion, the following section, particular occasions and circumstances, seeks to rectify the situation with some of the following categories: seasons, spring, summer, harvest, winter, birthday hymns, meeting and party of Christian friends, young and old, Sunday school, Hubbuck and National Blessings. Now, therefore, hymns selected and original, Weifgemeinschaften Gesangbuch before it, omits or severely reduces the other more objective elements of the Christian faith. There's no section devoted to the liturgical year. Section 8 is devoted to the life of Christ, which, if one counts the introductory section on his divinity, consists of a total of 45 hymns dedicated to his life from birth to resurrection, ascension, intercession, and glory. Only 4% of the hymnal is devoted to the wife of Christ or by extension liturgical year. It seems that the paucity of hymns devoted to the historic life of Christ, as typically manifest through the liturgical year, as well as the dearth of sacramental hymns in relation to the high percentage of hymns devoted to experiential concerns, only serves to turn theological concern inward and toward the observable, rational world instead upon the mysteries of faith. Indeed, a typical Lutheran hymnal published by the Lutheran General Synod in upcoming decades, such as Hymns Selected and Original in 1857, often resembled a Baptist or Methodist hymn book as opposed to a Lutheran one, because they included many frontier revival-style songs, much more so than any Lutheran chorale. Of course, having so many Baptist and Methodist hymnals on hand for appropriation and free of copyright concerns no doubt facilitated this hymnological transformation. The sermon, from which the most useful and practical benefit might be derived, usurps the full breadth and compass of the liturgy and the hymnody, which is subservient to it. At its apex, the spiritual depth of the Reformation worship has been reduced to a course of lectures on practical piety based on the catechism, explaining the rise, progress, nature, evidences of true conversion, and the duties of the professed disciples of Christ. But that's not where it stands. This strand of hymnody reflects the earliest American Lutherans, those who were increasingly eager to assimilate with their new country. In Pennsylvania, the Lutherans intermingled with the Reform, producing union hymnals such as the Gemeinschaftliche Gesangbuch, which omitted the unique theologies of both Lutheran and Reformed. Elsewhere, the tendency was for Lutherans to gravitate to the Episcopal Church, especially if they desired services in English. This is John Quitman, Friedrich Quitman's own son, John Anthony. He was an American Southern politician for whom Texas' own Quitman County is named. He became an Episcopal, most likely out of convenience rather than out of theological inclination. But the political upheavals in Europe during the late 1840s brought immigrants from Lutheran lands who were more keen to preserve their faith and less interested in assimilation, leading to a much more conservative theological approach, as evidenced in the history of the constituent bodies which formed the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod. These immigrants have been driven, this is the Vaser, which brought many immigrants to the port of Indianola in Texas. These immigrants have been driven from their homes due to the religious persecution suffering under the Edicts of the Prussian Union of 1817. They had absolutely no interest in compromising their language nor their theology. Rationalism elicited a reactionary response from these groups, whose confessional identity was clarified in contrast to rationalism. The newly founded Lutheran Church Missouri Synod published its first hymnal, the Kirchengesangbuch für Evangelische Lutherische Gemeinde, in 1847. It was a conservative endeavor which made no attempt at accommodating rationalist thought. Of the 443 hymns therein, a striking 150, or 33%, are dedicated to the liturgical year, including such relatively minor festivals as Holy Trinity, the Feast of John the Baptist, the Visitation of Mary, St. Michael's Day, and no fewer than six hymns devoted to Reformation. There are 22 Lenten hymns and 20 Easter hymns, a ratio of surprising parity. Martin Luther's hymns are well represented, as are Gerhardt's and many of the 17th century Pietists, but few of the rationalists, such as Gilbert. Walther avoided the liturgical minimalism so espoused by the rationalist writers, even including responsive antiphons, a selection of proper prefaces to the communion liturgy, the creeds, including the Athanasian, a complete reprint of Luther's small catechism and a lectionary. Shaping subsequent hymnals throughout the 19th century, this significant hymnal remained in publication in German at least to the earliest 20th century. I have a copy from 1909. Now, the founder of the LCMS, C.F.W. Walther, who gives us all our LCMS people our fashion sense, expressed suspicion, if not outright disdain, for nearly every principle on which the rationalists had so winsomely expounded. When responding to a German letter in 1883 inquiring as to the propriety of singing Methodist songs in a Lutheran Sunday school, Walther seeks no friends amongst the Methodists in his witheringly undiplomatic response, for which I take no responsibility. He says, "No, this is not advisable, rather very incorrect and pernicious. Our church is so rich in hymns that you could justifiably state that if one were to introduce Methodist hymns in a Lutheran school, this would be like carrying coals to Newcastle. The singing of such hymns would make the rich Lutheran church into a beggar, which is forced to beg from a miserable sect. 30 or 40 years ago, a Lutheran preacher might well have been forgiven this, for at that time, the Lutheran church in our country was poor as a beggar when it comes to songbooks. Our preacher scarcely knew where he might obtain such hymn books. Now, however, since our church itself has everything it needs, it is unpardonable when a preacher of our church causes anyone to suffer the shame of eating a foreign bread. In Methodist songs, there is much which is false and which contains spiritual poison for the soul. Therefore, it is soul murder to set this dinner before children, such as poisonous food." We'll just let it go with that. Fortunately, Walther's harsh criticism would eventually be seen as a historical anachronism, and LCMS hymnals throughout the 20th century would increasingly utilize the songs of Christian brethren denominations, hymnody which represented the broader spectrum of Christian orthodoxy. So finally, the Enlightenment posed fair questions to the Lutheran Church, the answers to which needed clarification for a modern world. By the late 18th century, it was not sufficient simply to follow Luther's suggestion to poke the eye out of reason and enter hell blind. The content of the first American Lutheran hymnal was largely conservative, partially a function of Gutenberg's drawing on the rich German language tradition. Quitman's later attempt to compare God to a great instructor may seem as absurd as Walther is comparing the singing of Methodist hymns to Schoenberger, but both represent honest attempts to deal with doctrinal nuance in an increasingly hostile world. So too must we realize that Quitman's progressive ideals necessitated utilizing English materials, of which there were few that faithfully represented traditional Lutheran theology. The theological trends of the 20th century and the continual realignment of denominations to the present day reveal that there is still much disagreement as to this sola scriptura principle, whether in hymnody or preaching or teaching. The questions of what is faith and what is reason and how do they relate may continue to provide fuel for acrimonious controversy, but ultimately reveal a faithfulness to the question of Luther's small catechism so frequently exhorts us to ask, what does this mean?
Sometimes in the history of Lutheranism, distinction, I guess, has been made between hymns for public worship and hymns for devotional purposes. And I noticed in the 1857 hymn selected original, it said for public and private worship. So just wanted to know your comments. Is there a true dichotomy of some sort?
Yeah, consider the earliest hymns, like about the Wiedersong. You know, you didn't have a preponderance of hymnals from which to choose. So your whole devotional life, whether liturgical or personal, came from generally one book. You had the catechism, you had the hymnal, you had your Bible. So that's why these many categories exist. You probably weren't meant to sing hymns dedicated to the death of a minister in church. Probably not. You'd focus more on the Easter hymn. But they would be something that would be part of private devotions. Now, interestingly, this Gemeinschaftsgesang of 1870, on the 300th anniversary of the Reformation, that was meant to be left in the pews. It used by Lutheran and Reformed in the same place. So that suggests to me a more liturgical use. Maybe not, but these were meant to be used by in one building, by two congregations. That suggests a liturgical use rather than a personal use, yet those kind of obtuse categories still exist.
Question. I got the sense, and tell me if I'm misinterpreting, that Pietism leads more naturally to rationalism than maybe orthodoxy.
Well, and I would say it this way: it's a turning inward. If you look at the order of salvation, the Ordo Salutis, I think it's Pietism and rationalism are more similar. While Pietism looks to your emotions to answer the questions of faith, rationalism looks to your reason, but either way, it's an inward focus. And Christ, and Luther always pointed to Christ. You know, so if there was an inward focus, you know, you're in the wrong place. That's why I start off with Luther's hymns. They're Christocentric. They always point to Christ. And there's hymns for all sorts of reasons that may only point to Christ obscurely. But as long as you maintain that Christocentricity, that's I think what Luther had in mind, and would constitute Orthodox Lutheran hymnody, from which Pietism and Lutheranism, Pietism and rationalism both departed.
Does Quitman believe in the divinity of Christ?
I've gone through his whole entire catechism here. His whole entire catechism. He doesn't believe in the Trinity. He has some conception of the divinity of Christ, yes. Christ is not simple.
The Holy Spirit doesn't exist.
Well, the Holy Spirit is an ambiguous spirit. He's not clear on that. He never uses the word Trinity once. So as far as I can figure out, Christ is divine. He's not simply a model. But he's not part of the Trinity as traditional orthodoxy has seen.
So divinity in its fullness inheres in the Creator only. Is that right?
Yes, I think that would be fair. And I think that speaks to why he spends so little time on the life of Christ and just uses him as an example. But yeah, he doesn't just he, doesn't come out right and say Christ was a man, you know. In fact, he doesn't deny the resurrection. He denies most of the other miracles, but he doesn't deny the resurrection. And the fact that he seems to be unclear about it, part of it may do have to do with the language, because his English in this catechism is not real good. I mean, clearly English wasn't his first language. So I'm not sure what to be able to ascribe to him, what were his own thoughts, and what I'm just trying to interpret from poorly written English.
Okay, we have a 15-minute break here, and we begin again at 11:15.